Hello everyone, I welcome you all once again on this e-learning portal, and today's topic is the second poem in your syllabus entitled as An Elementary School Classroom in a Slum. This poem, it has been penned down by Stephen Spender. We'll discuss a little about the poet first and then we'll move ahead with the poem. Sir Stephen Herold Spender, he was an English poet, novelist, essayist, and he concentrated on themes of social injustice and class struggle mainly in his work. This poem in particular, entitled as An Elementary School Classroom in a Slum, it is a political voice that you find resonating throughout the poem. In this poem, Spender raises his voice against capitalism and social injustice. In general, although his poem does not name any country or race here, the capitalistic government is supposed to supply equal opportunities for education, but the classroom in the slum offers very little hope for change or progress for its lower class students. The students in the slum classroom are underprivileged and malnourished. Stephen Spender, he was an English poet, as already we have discussed, and he had keen interest in politics. He was a social reformer as well, as he had raised his voice against the social injustice in specific in all his writings. He became disillusioned by his tries to socialism, and that is how he came up with a lot of writings. In the book entitled as The God That Failed, it's a very interesting book. One must read it. Now, we quickly go through the values that are raised in this particular poem by Stephen Spender. So you will find a sensitivity here towards the underprivileged section of the society. He talks about equity and equality. And the third thing that's very important, he here wants to create certain awareness in the different strata, different echelons of society about it, about this prevailing inequality. And there's a philanthropy as well that he took into consideration while penning down this poem. And at last, he is optimistic about what his expectancy is about in the end note of the poem. The theme of the poem is poverty and class discrimination. The poet underlines abject poverty of children in the slum area through his descriptions of such a classroom where the children are reeling under poverty. He thus exposes a sad, hidden segment of society that barely manages to survive. These children are weighed down, paper-seeming, diseased, twisted. And these are the few words that he had made use of to lay that emphasis. Such poverty is created through the oppressive power of capitalism. So the main theme over here is the poverty and the class discrimination. And the hidden segment of society that barely manages to survive. They are hand-to-mouth people, and it's very difficult for them to make a one square meal. So poverty that is created via oppressive power of capitalism, that is the main theme of the poem. Now, background of the poem, that's very important. It will be of great help to all of you while you will prepare your notes pertaining to this topic. So this, it has been written in 1964, and it is one of the best examples of Spender's political voice resonating in the form of verses. He here expresses his ideological positions on government, economics, and education as well. The students in the particular classroom that Spender here has weaved around, they are underprivileged and they are malnourished. The capitalistic government that is supposed to supply equal opportunity for education among all the echelons of society, but the classroom in this slum area, it offers a little hope for any kind of a change or progress. It is a commentary about racial issues, specifically about the American education. And also at the same time, he talks about a socialist proclamation against capitalism and social injustice in general. So we already have discussed that Stephen Spinder, he had wrote a lot about society, the real ground problems that prevails in society. Although Spinder, he was British, but the poem names no nation here in particular, right? So it was a response to the global question concerning social injustice, which was an essential issue in the American civil rights movement of those times. So these points you need to remember. And the last point over here, while we discuss under the topic background of the poem, this topic, this particular point, you should remember, the poet's tone, it changes from pensive to belligerent and frustrated to an appeal. So in the beginning of the poem, the mood was pretty different. Spinder, he uses the classroom and the children in his poem to underline the struggle between proletarians and burgeonizers. So there is a huge gulf between the slum school children and the wealthy donors, right? So these donors in the society who claim to provide certain benefit to society, but actually the picture is pretty different. So the mood was grim in the first three stanzas that transformed in the last stanza. So how this transformation happens, that we're going to discuss line by line. So towards the last stanza, the poet spells hope for the children with the coming of a governor or inspector or visitor, all these people in power. And the poem ends on a note of expectancy. So there is a certain expectation that he has from the society, that he has from the people who are in power. The setting of the poem, that paints the picture of a slum classroom, where these underprivileged students who are deprived and emaciated, so they are compelled to study in that dingy, foggy, dim classroom. So this offers a very little hope for any kind of a change or any kind of a progress for the lower class students. So this does not explicitly name any country, location, race or citizenship. But the intent of the poet is to shed light on social injustices worldwide. So that is one theme of the poem that he has taken and he weaved around it. So this is a picture that provides a view to elementary school classroom, how the students, they are sitting on the floor and what drastic and poor condition that they are living in. We begin with the poem. So the beginning line of the poem that says, far, far from gusty waves, these children's faces like rootless weeds. The hair torn around their pallor, the tall girl with her weighed down head. Along with the lines, I have made mention of the difficult words along with the meaning so that while you go back to revise the poem, so it is a self-explanatory kind of a lesson. So, meanwhile, you will go back to it. It would be more clear to you. So, the poem opens with a dreary depiction of the students in a slum classroom. The first child introduced is a tall girl with weighed down head. Her head is evidently weighed down due to physical, mental, and emotional exhaustion. The other children in the class are also in a miserable condition. So, what the condition is there, we'll move forward. First, we'll discuss the poetic devices here in these lines, far from gusty waves. So this word has been repeated here. Then I'm not going to name any poetic device. I'm just making it more clear to you. You find the answer to it, though the poetic devices are mentioned at the end of the lesson. Like rootless weeds. So the faces, they have been compared to rootless weeds. Weeds, certain kind of the plants that grows out of nowhere at their own. So they have been, the children's faces have been compared to the rootless weeds with the word like here. So that's the simplest of the poetic device. I hope you would have got it right now. We move ahead. These are the words given there along with the meaning. For better understanding, the paper seeming boy with rat's eyes, the stunted, unlucky hero of twisted bones, reciting a father's gnarled disease, his lesson from his desk. At back of the gym class, one unnoted, sweet and young, his eyes live in a dream of a squirrel's game in the tree room other than this. So the first example that has been mentioned by the poet was of a tall girl with a weighed down head. Now the other children in the class, they are also miserable, right? Here, the second example that has been quoted was of a paper-seeming boy with rat's eyes. So it implies that the boy is malnourished and too weak. His eyes are defensive and scared like a scavenger, a rat. His prospect for survival, let alone success, right? So it is very bleak idea here. Yet another child who is stunted, who is unlucky here of twisted bones, the child is the victim of a genetic disorder. Spindler writes that the boy has inherited his father's Snell disease. He has been left disfigured. He's trapped in a physically challenged body. So there is no respite for the dwellers of the slum. So they were caught in a vicious cycle of poverty and class discrimination. The generations are diseased. Posterity after another, they all are diseased. The boy at the back of the gym class, he has eyes that live in a dream. The student is unclear whether he is dreaming of a life in the future or is just distracted by the squirrel's game. So this boy, unnoted, sweet and young, may also represent hope for social change as his eyes dream of success. So they also have the right to dream and to live it further, provided they have a right opportunity. So you see what drastic condition these kids, they were living in, they were studying in. These words would help you out while you will go again to the explanatory part of the poem. Coming to the environment of class, on sour cream walls, donations. Shakespeare's head, cloudless at dawn, civilized dawn rising all cities. Belt, flowery, Tyrese Valley, open-handed map awarding the world its world. And yet for those children, these windows, not this world, our world, when all their futures painted with a fog, a narrow street sealed in with a lit sky. Far, far from riverscapes and stars of words. So there's a little charity also that has been made by so-called goody-good people of the society. But actually, it made no difference. Here, in the second stanza of the poem, Spindler describes a classroom with sore cream walls and its contents as well. The classroom is strung together with donations that are apparently doled out to the slum classroom by the Borgies. The Borgies are the rich class students, a class that has oppressed them socially and economically here, so it's entirely contrasting. For these children of proletarians, the classroom is constructed through donations of others' capital. So all that the students possess comes from their oppressors. The upper class, which constricts the children in a neat bracket of poverty, also offers them their only tools to escape. So what are these tools to escape here? As it is mentioned clearly, the maps and the Shakespeare's head. It gives the students a glimpse of the world beyond their daily existence in the slum. However, to these children, there is no road to reach out these places. The Shakespeare head actually symbolizes the intellectual people. So they hardly able to manage one day meal, one square meal. And what these walls were offering to them is the Shakespeare or the civilized domes that are, you know, writing all over the city. So they have all the maps that could take them to the world round, but there are no roads. So when there is no road wire, they could reach out these places. There is no use of these things. So through the donations, the slum children are offered a glimpse of a world that is much alien to them and often incomprehensible to them. Unlike their foggy slum and narrow streets sealed in with a lit sky, the donations show actually what? The donations show them that these built flowery Tyrose valleys, and this is all cloudless, right? They make no sense to all of them. The future of these children is bleak, grim and unknown in a slum trapped by their social and economic status. So even the condition of the room wherein they came to receive certain education, it's all foggy. And there are these fake dreams that the people are showing to them. Now, few words, important words to discuss. Tyrolese Valley, so that's an extrapolator I have added over here. That's a beautiful ice-free valley in Austria. So this is a picture of Tarlos Valley. It's beautiful, beautiful place. So that is why we lay emphasis here on, because it's entirely contrasting to their present condition. It is also called as Tyrol Valley, and it is a high ice-free valley lying east of Mount Belvoir in the Asgard Range, Victoria Land. Why this valley has been named so? Because an Austrian biologist, Heinz Jenschek, a participant in the United States Antarctic Research Program, so his native place was Tyrol. So that is how the valley has been named as Tyrol's Valley. We move ahead to the next stanza. The meaning of the words are given to you. So surely Shakespeare is wicked, the map a bad example, with ships and sun and love tempting them to steal. For lives that slyly turn in their cramped holes, from fog to endless night. On their slag heap, these children wear skins peeped through by bones and spectacles of steel. Particularly this line, wear skins peeped through by bones and spectacles of steel. You should remember, mark it important. That pertains to a very important question. With mended glass, like bottle bits on stones, all of their time and space are foggy slum. So blot their maps with slums as big as doom. In this stanza, Spindle questions the reality of the students' futures. He raises the ironical questions whether Shakespeare is wicked and the map a bad example, because these give children ideas about escaping from lit skies to sun-filled worlds and a love for life rather than dread or disillusionment. So they expose the children to pictures and story of ships and sun and love, and they're actually tempting them, these students, to steal. By exposing the students to the beauties of the world, so the bodies appear to be assisting the slum to commit crime. They tempt them by showing them a different kind of world that is out of their reach, a world that they cannot even dream of reaching, in fact. They are doomed to cramped holes in limited, restrictive lives that progress from ignorance. So ignorance, it has been made clear by the use of word fog here, to death, and that is what the endless night. So Spender here and describes the miserable plight of these children on their slag heap. The children are thin and they wear skins peeped through by bones. So they are so malnourished, in fact their skins that is peeping out of the bones are peeping out of their skin. They also wear spectacles of steel with mended glass, like bottles bits on stones. Pay attention to this line. Spindler expresses the outrage at humanity's disregard for the children, who are mere skin and bone. Their maps of the future are irreparably blotted by fate. So it does all depend on the fate there. So how ironic it is, at the one hand, those picture of Shakespeare, Tyrol's Valley, the huge maps that has been given to them as donations, but actually they did not need them. They need a real education. They need that opportunity. We move ahead. So these two important words here. Unless governor, inspector, visitor, this map becomes their window, and these windows that shut upon their lives like catacombs. Do remember the line here, that shut upon their lives like catacombs. Break or break. So this is an appeal that begins here. Break or break, open till they break the town and show the children to green fields and make their world. Run azure on gold sands and let their tongues run naked into books. The white and green leaves open, history theirs whose language is the sun. In the last stanza, Spindler comes full circle. So he's quite optimistic, quite hopeful here. Hopelessness is replaced by hope and pessimism by optimism. He is imploring the governor, the inspector, the visitor to transform the temptation of donations into a reality. So there is an urgency in his tone as he begs for a change that will break or break open the windows. So windows that shut upon their lives like catacombs and free the children from the constraint of their position in society. Once out of the slum, these children can find their green fields and the gold sand. Spindler also hopes that the children will be able to let their tongues run naked into books. The white and green leaves open. So he feels that if students are truly allowed free exploration, Then their language will become the sun, burning away the fog that has sealed their fates and doomed them to an elementary school classroom in that slum area. So that is what about the poem. All the difficult words has been mentioned in each slide. We move ahead here to certain questions. So there are these three questions that I have mentioned here. These are very important questions. Go through them. If you feel you can add to the answers, go ahead. So these are the short important questions pertaining to the poem. Take your notes, add to it, go through the poem once again. At the end of the poem, you will find an assignment that I suppose you will complete religiously for a better understanding of the poem, of the verse, a very beautifully written poem by Stephen Spender about the social injustice. Here, before the assignment comes in, we talk about poetic devices because you will have a short question about the poetic devices of the lines given in the poem. Similarly, that was very clear in the line, like rootless weeds, while their faces has been compared to the rootless weeds. There are lot many metaphorical examples in the poem. So metaphor that prevails almost, you know, in one or the other line in the poem. There are many examples of it. While the boy is compared with the paper as he is thin, the paper seeming boy. Crammed holes, while their homes are very small, just like holes. The sore cream walls that are the dull walls. Also the narrow street sealed with the lead sky. So the future of the kids that is described as foggy, as limited. And the white green leaves open. Books in the nature, they are expressed in the form of the colors, the white and the green. And the object has been taken there is the leaves. Few more poetic devices prevails in the poem is repetition, the use of word far to stress on distance. The poem itself begins with far, far from. Then assonance you find there, the repetition of vowel sound E, belled, flowery, tarly, velly. So this E sound that has been repeated over here, so that is assonance. Then allusion, the reference to well-known person or place, so Shakespeare's head. And Tyrolese Willy, that is allusion, that's imagery in fact here. Alliteration, the use of for sound in from fog. So, anaphora, the last one, use of repeated words in two consecutive lines, run azure, run naked. So, that is about the poetic devices that has been used in the poem. So, this is assignment pertaining to the poem. Question number one, that is a task one to you that you need to answer in 30 to 40 words. The poem dwells on squalor but ends on an optimistic note. Discuss about it. So meanwhile, you'll go back to the lecture. You will find out the answer to it very well. Task two, mark it a very important value-based question pertaining to the poem. The poem exposes the widespread neglect of all nationalities, races and ethnicities. So the poet pleads for equal opportunity for education, thereby appealing to the people to be more sensitive to their needs. So a justification that you need to add within 180 to 200 words here. So go through the poem once again, twice, thrice as per your wish. If you have any question, you can post in the comment tab. I'll get back to you earliest possible. Happy learning and stay tuned for the next lessons. And please do take care of yourself and your family very well. So the time is tough, but it will go. If we are together, we can change anything and everything. Thank you, everyone. Happy learning.